Welcome to Physics with Joe. Today we're going to be looking at equations of constant acceleration. What I'm going to talk about is what are these six different variables that always show up in any problem dealing with constant acceleration? What are the equations of constant acceleration and how do you use them? I'll give you a simple problem-solving strategy that will work for most problems. And we'll do an example or two to solidify this problem-solving strategy. So let's jump right into it. Let's begin by looking at the six different quantities that you will see whenever you're doing a problem involving constant acceleration. I call these the usual suspects because, as you'll see in a little while, anytime you're doing a problem involving constant acceleration, these are the six different quantities you will always be dealing with. You've got initial position, final position, initial velocity, final velocity, acceleration, and elapsed time. Anytime you're looking at some event, you're always going to have sort of a beginning of the event and an end of the event. It might be like a car starts from rest and accelerates at a constant 3 meters per second squared for 5 seconds. The beginning of the event was when the car was at rest. The end of the event was 5 seconds later after the car has stopped accelerating. Well, initial position is just where the object is at the beginning of that event. Generally, we refer to the beginning as t equals zero, but it does not have to be. So initial position is just what is my value of x, if we're talking about horizontal motion, where's the object relative to the origin at the beginning of the event. Final position is at the end of the event, after the elapsed time has occurred, what is the object's final position. Initial velocity is just the velocity of the object at the beginning of that event, at the beginning of t equals zero, or my start time. Final velocity is just the velocity that I end with. Acceleration. Now, we assume the acceleration is constant. That's the only way we can use these equations of constant acceleration that we'll get to, which means there is no initial acceleration and final acceleration because the acceleration does not change. And elapsed time is really just t final minus t initial. It's how much time has elapsed since the beginning of my event and the end of my event. Now, in one dimension, we can look at either horizontal or vertical motion. In the x direction, the variables that I'm going to use for these six quantities, I'm going to use x naught for initial position, x for final position, v naught x for initial velocity, vx for final velocity, ax for acceleration, and delta t for elapsed time. If we're talking about vertical motion, so motion only along a vertical line, the quantities I will use are y naught for initial position, y for final position, v naught y for initial velocity, vy for final velocity, ay for acceleration, and again delta t for elapsed time. Notice there is no delta tx or delta ty because time is a scalar and you cannot have x and y components for time. Now that we know what the different quantities are, let's take a look at the equations of constant acceleration. Three quick points before I go through the equations of constant acceleration. One, as the name implies, the acceleration must be constant in order for you to use these equations, which means the magnitude of the acceleration has to be constant and the direction of the acceleration has to be constant. Two, depending upon the textbook that you use, the notation for the different variables might be slightly different. For example, instead of x naught for initial position, your textbook might use x initial. Or instead of delta t for elapsed time, your textbook might just use t. It's a superficial change, just make sure you know what each variable's notation is for your textbook. And then three, I'm not deriving these equations for you. They're derived in any physics textbook. What I want to focus on is how do you use these equations. The four equations of constant acceleration in the x direction, so if we're talking about horizontal motion, are as follows. Vx equals v naught x plus ax times delta t. My final velocity equals my initial velocity plus acceleration times delta t. Second equation, x minus x naught equals v naught x times delta t plus 1/2 ax times delta t squared. My final position minus my initial position equals my initial velocity times delta t plus 1/2 my acceleration times delta t squared. These are the two main equations, and you can pretty much solve any constant acceleration problem just using these two equations. The other two, however, are also useful in different situations. Third equation, vx squared equals v naught x squared plus 2ax x minus x naught. The final velocity squared equals the initial velocity squared plus 2 times the acceleration times my final minus initial position. And then last but not least, x minus x naught equals 1/2 v naught x plus vx times delta t. My final position minus my initial position equals 1/2 my initial velocity plus my final velocity times delta t. Now, if we're talking about vertical motion, so just motion straight up and down in a straight line, the equations are exactly the same, except everywhere there was an x, now there was a y. So the four equations are vy equals v naught y plus ay times delta t, y minus y naught equals v naught y times delta t plus 1/2 ay delta t squared, vy squared equals v naught y squared plus 2ay y minus y naught, and last but not least, y minus y naught equals 1/2 v naught y plus vy times delta t. Well, those are the equations. Let's now look at an example problem. I'll go through step by step how to do it, and then I'll summarize the problem solving strategy for you that you can use for almost any constant acceleration problem. Let's finally take a look at an example problem. For this example problem, we have A. What is the magnitude of the constant acceleration of a car which, starting from rest, reaches a speed of 8 meters per second after accelerating for 5 seconds? And then B, how far does the car travel in this time? Well, the first step to any physics problem is read the problem and actually visualize what's going on. Don't just start plugging numbers into an equation. Take the time, read the problem carefully, and then think about what's actually going on. In this case, it's pretty straightforward. I had a car that was initially at rest. It accelerates for 5 seconds and reaches a speed of 8 meters per second. We want to know what was the acceleration and how far does the car travel in this time. So sometimes it helps to draw a quick sketch or a diagram. Like I said, in this case, pretty straightforward. I'm going to call my initial condition when the car was at rest, my final condition after it's accelerated for 5 seconds and reached a speed of 8 meters per second. And I'm just going to assume the car is moving to the right, so my velocity and my acceleration are both going to be positive. Next step is identify all the known and unknown quantities. In this case, we were told the car starts from rest. Ding, 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 ding. Anytime you hear the phrase starts from rest or starting from rest, we know that that means the initial velocity is zero. So starting from rest, in this case, we know my initial velocity then is going to be 0 meters per second. So I'm going to write that down here. My initial velocity, 0 meters per second. After 5 seconds of accelerating, an elapsed time of 5 seconds, I've reached a speed of 8 meters per second, and I want to know what is the acceleration. Now, one other thing we can assume. We always have the option of defining our origin wherever we want. And if I define my initial position to be the origin, then that means my initial position x naught is 0 meters. So now I've got 4 known quantities, 2 unknown quantities. And then the next step is to find the equation that has the unknown quantity and your known quantities. And one nice thing you can do until you have done this enough that you know what equation to use is set up this little table here where I've got the equation and then what variables that equation has and which variables it's missing. So for example, vx equals v naught x plus ax delta t. It has v naught x, it has vx, it has ax, and it has delta t, but it doesn't have x naught or x, which means I can't use that equation to solve for x or x naught. Well, we want the acceleration. I want my acceleration. I've got delta t, I've got vx, I've got v naught x, and I've got x naught. I can then look at this chart and see what equation has my unknown quantity ax and my known quantities. In this case, this first equation, vx equals v naught x plus ax delta t, I've got vx, I've got v naught x, I've got delta t, I'm looking for the acceleration. So what we do is we start with the equation, vx equals v naught x plus ax delta t. And then what you do not want to do is start plugging in numbers right away. The next step is to solve algebraically for the unknown quantity and then plug your values in. And what I like to do personally is plug in any values that are zero before solving algebraically for the unknown quantity. It just makes the algebra a little bit easier. So in this case, the object started from rest, so my v naught x is zero. So this equation reduces to vx equals ax delta t, and then I can solve for my unknown quantity, which in this case is the acceleration. So my acceleration is going to be vx divided by delta t. I can then plug in my values. Vx is 8 meters per second. My delta t is 5 seconds, and what I get is my acceleration is 1.6 meters per second squared. So now we have the acceleration. I can actually write that down right here. My acceleration we just solved for was 1.6 meters per second squared. Now we want to know how far does the car travel in this time. Well, if I have x naught, my initial position is zero, I just need to solve for my final position x. And that'll tell me how far it's traveled during that time. Well, in this case, I now have all my quantities except for x. And if I look, I could use this first equation, or I'm sorry, this second equation. I've got x, I'm looking for x, I have x naught, I've got v naught x, I've got delta t, I've got ax. I could also use this third equation, or I could use this fourth equation. And one nice thing about these equations is oftentimes you can use a different equation to check your results from one of the other ones. Well, let's use this second equation. X minus X naught equals V naught XT plus 1/2 AX delta T squared. And again, what I want to do next is solve for my unknown variable. But first, I think it's easiest to plug in any quantities that are zero. So my initial position I've defined as zero. My initial velocity was zero. So this equation reduces to x equals 1/2 ax times delta t squared. Now I can plug in my values. I've got 1/2. My acceleration is 1.6 meters per second squared. My time was 5 seconds. I multiply everything through, and what I get is x equals 20 meters, or 2.0 times 10 to the 1 meters. Well, let's double check our result using one of the other equations. And let's just use that final equation. X minus x naught equals 1/2 v naught x plus vx times delta t. Again, we're going to solve for our unknown quantity, but first I'm going to plug in anything that is zero just to make the algebra a little bit easier. So my initial position was zero, my initial velocity was zero. This equation reduces down to x equals 1/2 vx times delta t. Now I can plug in my known quantities. My vx is 8 meters per second. My delta t is 5 seconds, and what I get is x equals 20 meters, 2.0 times 10 to the 1 meters. And then the final step is just to make sure that your answer seems reasonable. Does it make sense that the car would travel about 20 meters in 5 seconds if its final speed was 8 meters per second? The answer is yes. Now, initially, you may not have a good feel for whether the magnitude is reasonable, but you can make sure that if you're solving for time, getting a negative time doesn't make sense. Your units always have to work out, and you want to make sure that the magnitude of your answer seems reasonable. Well, that's really it for a simple problem. Now let's look at a step-by-step problem-solving strategy that you can use for almost any problem.
This problem-solving strategy should work for most problems that you'll encounter when dealing with constant acceleration. Step number one, read the problem and visualize what's happening. A big mistake I see physics students make is they look at a problem, they find out some numbers, and they start trying to plug into an equation without really thinking about what's going on. So read the problem, really close your eyes and visualize what's going on, and draw a sketch or a diagram if necessary. Step two, identify the known and unknown quantities. So you're always going to have at least one unknown quantity that you're looking for. So identify that unknown quantity as well as the known quantity. Step three, find the equation or equations that contain your unknown quantity as well as known quantities. And then step four is you want to solve algebraically for the unknown quantity. A big mistake I see physics students make is they start plugging numbers into an equation too soon. That should be the very last step that you do. First thing you want to do, solve algebraically for the unknown quantity. Personally, I like to plug in anything that's zero first before I solve algebraically. It just makes the algebra a little bit easier. Step five is now you're plugging in the numbers. So here's where you actually take your values, plug it into your equation to get a final answer. And then step six, make sure that your final answer seems reasonable. Does the magnitude seem about right? Do I get the correct units and so on? Let me say a quick word about identifying the known and unknown quantities and then finding the equation that has your unknown quantity plus known quantities. I think the easiest way to do this initially, until you've done enough problems that this becomes much easier, is creating a chart where you've got the four different equations. For each equation, you put the six different variables and list which variables are contained in each equation. For example, Vx equals V naught x plus Ax delta t. That equation contains my initial velocity V naught x, my final velocity Vx, my acceleration Ax, and my elapsed time delta t. I cannot use that equation to solve for x or x naught because that equation does not contain those variables. Then once you identify the known and unknown quantities, you can use this table to figure out which equation has everything you need. For example, let's say a problem stated, starting from rest, a car accelerates at plus 6.5 meters per second squared for a distance of 225 meters. What is the race car's final speed? In this particular example, you're told that the race car moves a distance of 225 meters. If I let my initial position x naught be zero, my final position x is going to be 225 meters. I know it started from rest, so my initial velocity is zero. I know the acceleration was 6.5 meters per second squared, and I want my final velocity. I can get my final speed from that. Well, that means I've got x naught, I've got x, I've got v naught x, I've got vx, and I've got ax. What I do not have is delta t. And then using my handy little chart, I can see that the only equation that doesn't have delta t but has all my other quantities is that third equation, Vx squared equals V naught x squared plus 2ax x minus x naught. I can then solve that equation for my unknown quantity, in this case Vx, and then get the answer. Well, that is really it. Thank you so much for joining me. I'm going to do another more complicated example problem in my next video. I was planning on doing it in this video, but I'm trying to keep them relatively short, between about 10 and 15 minutes. And I've already gone over the limit for this video. So tune in next time and I'll look at another constant acceleration problem that involves multiple steps. Until then, this has been Physics with Joe. Thanks so much for joining me. Boop, 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 boop.